Good morning, everyone, and thank you. It's a real privilege and a pleasure to be here. Let me start with the confessions, which is I am not an AI expert. I am not a computer scientist. I have to confess I'm a lawyer and I'm a social scientist. I'm a regulatory governance scholar. And today I'm going to share with you some of the ideas I've been having about the concept of algorithmic regulation. These are very much thoughts in process, and I would certainly welcome your feedback. So let me begin then by reminding you of all the claims about the current era, that we are witnessing a new industrial revolution made possible by network digital technologies, cloud computing, and powered by the engine of big data. And this is very evident in the rapid take-up we see across the commercial sector, which is radically transforming service delivery across a wide range of industries, including finance, marketing, retail, media, health, dating and mating, and so forth. So a number of people have suggested that we should apply these techniques, the techniques used by Google, Amazon, Facebook, and the like, to the tasks of social coordination, to the tasks of regulatory governance. So what I want to do today is to subject this phenomenon, which I'm going to refer to as algorithmic regulation, to critical examination from various strands of the social science and from legal scholarship. So just to give you a sense of where I'm going to go with this, I'm going to start by offering a definition of algorithmic regulation. I'm then going to drill down and examine the underlying logic of algorithmic regulation, and I'm going to suggest one taxonomy for the purposes of critical social evaluation, and I'm going to broadly suggest that we can identify two basic forms, very bluntly speaking, reactive systems on one hand and predictive systems on the other. And then I'm going to try and subject that logic to a bit more of a systematic critique, looking at it through the lens of social theory, I guess you could say, thinking about algorithmic regulation as a system of social ordering. So to do that, I'm going to talk a little bit about the politics of algorithmic regulation, the rise of the new surveillance, the rise of algorithmic power, demands for algorithmic accountability, and the implications for the social foundations of democracy before drawing some conclusions. So let me start then with the phenomenon of algorithmic regulation. If you do a Wikipedia search, you will see that the term algorithmic regulation is credited to Silicon Valley entrepreneur Tim O'Reilly. And in a well-cited paper in 2013, Tim O'Reilly proclaims the great virtues of algorithmic regulation, but he doesn't actually define what it is. Instead, he simply identifies a number of technological systems. So he cites motor vehicle fuel emission systems, airline automatic pilot systems, credit card fraud detection systems, drug dosage monitoring by medical professionals, internet spam filters, and general internet search engines. And he says all of these systems share four core features. Firstly, a deep understanding of the desired outcome, real-time measurement to determine if that outcome is being achieved, algorithms, and by that he simply means a set of rules that make adjustments based on new data, and finally, periodic deeper analysis of whether the algorithms themselves are correct and performing as expected. So you get the general drift of what he's getting at, but for the purposes of critical evaluation, we need a slightly more focused definition. So I'm going to spend a few minutes trying to flesh out this idea and to offer you a working definition. So to my mind, algorithmic regulation refers to regulatory governance systems that utilize algorithmic decision making. So of course that begs the question, what do I mean by regulation or a regulatory governance system? Well, it turns out that, in fact, there's a large and growing scholarship in the field of regulation studies or regulation governance studies, and one of the leading scholars has defined regulation or regulatory governance as intentional attempts to manage risk or alter behavior in order to achieve some pre-specified goal. So it's a very broad definition, but it is, above all, intentional. I want to draw your attention to a few features of this definition. Firstly, it's true that regulation is primarily undertaken by governments, but it is also pursued by non-state actors and entities. Secondly, the size of the regulated population can be highly variable. It can range from a single individual who is using a tracking device to try and encourage them to undertake more regular physical activity, through to platforms like Facebook, which are interested in regulating the posting behaviour of its 3 billion users. But above all, regulation is an intentional activity directed at achieving some kind of pre-specified goal. So any regulatory system must have some kind of system director or regulator who determines the overarching goal of the regulatory system. So that's what I mean by regulation. What do I mean by algorithmic? Well, I guess I'm drawing on the work of Tarleton Gillespie here. He says algorithms are simply encoded procedures for solving a problem by transforming input data into a desired output based on specified calculations and procedures, and they don't need to be software. So a simple recipe to make a chocolate cake would qualify as an algorithm. However, from the perspective of the technical experts, people like you, you probably have a more precise understanding of what it means to describe something as algorithmic, and for software engineers, they probably see algorithms as referring to the logical series of steps for organising and acting on a body of data to achieve a desired outcome quickly, which comes after the generation of a model that is the formalisation of a problem and the goal in computational terms. But for people like me, for lawyers and social scientists, the core concern when we describe something as algorithmic is the largest socio-technical assemblage that includes not just the algorithm, the model, the target goal, the training data, the application and the hardware, but the entire social system that is all connected up to a broader social endeavour aimed at knowledge production, which we refer to as an algorithmic system. So this leads me to posit the following working definition. Algorithmic regulation refers to decision-making systems that regulate a domain of activity in order to manage risk or alter behaviour through continual computational generation of knowledge from data emitted and directly collected, typically in real time on a continuous basis, from numerous dynamic components pertaining to the regulated environment in order to identify and, if necessary, automatically refine or prompt the refinement of the system's operations to achieve a pre-specified goal. So that's a bit of a mouthful, but you get the gist of it. So let's start thinking about these kinds of decision-making systems. And to start thinking about it, it seems to me really useful to think about algorithmic regulation by thinking of its antecedents in the interdisciplinary science of cybernetics, which emerged after the Second World War. And this line of thinking sought to move away from linear understandings of cause-effect relationships towards investigations of control through circular causality or feedback. So one of the things I've been looking at for a long time in my research is the nature of control systems or regulatory governance systems. And according to cybernetic theory, all control systems have three core components. They have mechanisms for setting the standards. They have mechanisms for information and information gathering and monitoring to identify what is going on in the domain of interest. And thirdly, there have to be some kind of mechanism to detect violation and to sanction that violation in order to bring the behaviour back into line with the system goals whenever deviation is identified. So if we think about these three different components that a control system may have, I'm going to suggest that for the purposes of critical social analysis, we can think of each of these components having at least two alternative variations. So, of course, as you know, any taxonomy is really a heuristic for the purposes of some specific analytical aim. And so my aim here is to subject these kinds of systems to critical analysis. And so I'm not suggesting this is the only taxonomy, but it's one that I hope will help to illuminate the underlying logics. So at the level of standard setting, it can be configured as either a fixed or simple standard or a variable behavioural standard. At the level of monitoring and information gathering, it can be based on reactive or historic data, or it can simply take the data and try and infer from those patterns what is likely to happen in the future. So it can be predictive in its orientation. And at the level of enforcement and sanctions, they may be automated, no need for human intervention, or it can be configured as a recommender system, which leaves the human in the loop. So let me say a little bit more about each of these three dimensions. So at the level of standard setting, we can have a very simple fixed standard. So this is exemplified in the use of password protection systems to authorize access to digital content. But on the other hand, we can have much more sophisticated algorithmic systems which set standards that allow the behavioural standard to vary in line with whatever fixed, overarching, but reprogrammable system goal the regulatory system is designed to optimise. So, for example, in a smart or intelligent transportation scheme, we may see that variation is allowed in speed limits depending on the level of traffic and congestion, and we might see variation in the frequency and the timing of the traffic light signals with the ultimate aim of optimising traffic flow within the system. At the level of information and gathering and monitoring, we can have the information being gathered on a reactive basis, so it's tracking historic performance data in near real time in order to detect violations. So I'm sure you're familiar with motor vehicle violation technologies such as speed cameras, to which we have automated number plate recognition, and the aim of these systems is to detect speeding in real time and to keep a record so that fines can be issued to those who are driving beyond the speed limit. Or we can have predictive systems that seek to detect violations on a preemptive basis, or should I say, seek to forestall potential violations on a preemptive basis. And they apply machine learning algorithms to historic data in order to infer and thereby to predict future behaviour. So a well-known example of this, besides credit card fraud detection, is your digital shopping recommendation engine, which uses machine learning to predict the consumer profile of the particular individual and make suggestions about likely products of interest. At the level of enforcement and sanctioning, the administration of the decision or sanction may be instant and automatic, like your password protection system, so there's no need for human intervention. Or it might be a recommender system, a persuasive system which is configured to provide automated assistance to a human agent. And the basic aim of these systems is to prioritise candidates within a larger regulated population to offer salience to particular items of the data, prompting that human user to focus their attention on a particular set of entities within the data set, and leaves it to the human agent to decide what should happen based on their attention being directed to that particular set of data. So crime prediction software such as Predpol is an illustration of this. It's designed to try and identify geographic hotspots that are likely to arise in the future, but of course it's completely open to the human agent to ignore those recommendations. Well, although I've suggested that we can have essentially 12 different forms if we add them all up, for the purposes of critical analysis, I think it's useful to divide these systems into two basic forms. So we have reactive systems on the one hand, which trigger an automated response based on algorithmic analysis of historic performance data in real time. Or we can have preemptive systems, which act preemptively based on algorithmic assessment of historic data to infer predictions about future behaviour. So these two broad forms roughly track two important developments in the computerization of regulatory governance systems, which I think help us to identify what is it that is genuinely new or novel about these algorithmic regulatory systems. The first is automation, the second is the use of machine learning algorithms fed by large data streams. So let me say something first about automation. So in many ways, the computational turn has made it possible to automate a number of regulatory governance systems, just like digital password protection. And we see here an example of Procter & Gamble's Safeguard soap hygiene system, which apparently is being used in some Philippine public conveniences. And it basically operates by a movement sensor technology detector, which triggers an alarm when someone goes into the bathroom and goes into the stall. And when they close the door of the stall, it triggers an alarm. And you can only turn the alarm off by pushing the soap dispenser. So the idea is to prompt people to wash their hands before they leave the stall. So this kind of looks quite sophisticated, but in fact, it's a pretty primitive control system, okay? It is a form of design-based regulation, really not that much different to the water lock, which apparently was the first automated system, control system devised by the ancient Egyptians around about 3,000 years ago. So we have automated enforcement of a very simple control system. In many ways, they're not that interesting because these kinds of systems have been around for a long time. But what makes them interesting in the contemporary context is it's now actually practically and economically feasible to install systems of this kind because they're basically just not that expensive anymore. So it's now possible to put these into public facilities instead of just saying, sticking a note on the wall that says, please wash your hands. Okay, so it's much more immediate and direct than the kind of blunt forms of control that we had before. On the other hand, there is something that is really novel about these systems. And here I'm referring to the power of big data. The use of machine learning techniques that operate on large and multiple sources of data collected from ubiquitous digital sensors that continuously track behavior. And these, I'm going to suggest, offer a genuinely novel form of design-based control, because they enable smart forms of algorithmic regulation, which are configured to optimize a fixed, albeit reprogrammable, overarching system goal, which allows variation in the behavioral standards. And what's interesting and important about these systems is that they are extraordinarily powerful. So you can just compare the kind of system of control that is employed by Facebook in relation to its posting behavior of its 3 billion users with the humble speed hump. So in a sense, they are both design-based technologies designed to try and shape people's behavior, but you can imagine that the algorithmic system is so much more powerful because it can not only track and intervene in the behavior of a single user, but an entire population of users across a widely dispersed geographic area while collecting and analyzing population-wide data on an almost instantaneous basis to identify deviations from the system goal. As well as that, because of the machine learning, it's possible to make predictions, not just about the individual, but about the entire population, to identify trends that can reveal and automatically act upon the hidden insight. And it's this capacity to predict future action or behavior, which wouldn't be ordinarily detectable by human cognition or even through ordinary computing power, to generate actionable insights that is widely regarded as the holy grail of big data. So let's drill down a little bit to the logic of these systems. I'm running out of time, so I'm going to fly through these really quickly. In terms of algorithmic, reactive algorithmic systems, these are basically kind of hypercharged performance management systems. Okay, and we're familiar with performance management or outcome-based management systems in many domains, but they offer three claimed advantages. Firstly, we can replace the bluntness of human oversight with ubiquitous network digital sensors embedded into the environment, and this enables the monitoring of performance at a much more granular level at greatly reduced cost and human effort. They operate in real time and dynamically, continuously fed by data, and that means that the risk of out-of-date performance data is greatly reduced. And of course, they appear to be based on objective, verifiable evidence, because knowledge of system performance is based on data that is collected directly from behavioral sensors embedded into the environment, and thereby hold out the prospect of game-proof design. Well, preemptive systems offer the same kinds of advantages, but there are slightly different underpinning logics. I don't have time to talk about them, but drawing from social scientific analysis, they can be understood as a form of risk-based regulation, as a form of actuarial justice, and we saw some of that yesterday in some of the applications in the criminal justice context, and as a form of surveillance-driven social sorting, which has been used in the retail and marketing industries from the early days of data mining. But let's think about what are the implications? How should we think about these systems? Should we welcome them? Should we fear them? What should we make of these systems? Well, to do that, I'm going to suggest that it's useful to think of algorithmic regulation more generally as a system of social ordering, just in the way that social theorists have identified markets on the one hand and bureaucratic hierarchy on the other as two quite different ways to coordinate social activity. I'm going to suggest that algorithmic regulation can be understood as a third form of social ordering. Unfortunately, it's not my idea. Another sociologist back in 2009, Anisha Nish, identified algocracy as a system of governance based on rule of the algorithm. And he suggested that this was a new form of social ordering that is actually distinct from even though it's related to both bureaucratic and market forms of governance, but it's different because its underlying logic is driven by the algorithm, which is mathematical. So it seems to me this is an incredibly fruitful way of thinking about algorithmic regulation and a good platform to ground our critical examination. So I'm going to say a little bit about the politics and drivers of the turn to algorithmic regulation, the rise of algorithmic power, the new surveillance, and some legal and democratic concerns. So let me start with the politics of algorithmic regulation, and I suspect that some of you are probably saying, politics? What politics? There's no politics in algorithmic regulation. Well, some of you might be familiar with the recent bestseller by historian Yuval Harari, who coined the term dataism. And dataism was more than politics. In fact, he referred to it as an emerging religion, he said, rooted in a belief that humans can no longer distill the immense flows of data into information, knowledge, or wisdom, so that the work of processing data needs to be entrusted to computational algorithms whose capacity far exceeds that of the human brain. So one of the interesting things about dataism, as Harari conceives it, is that it actually transcends political ideology. He says, free market capitalism and communism are just two different forms of the same idea. They're just information processing systems, which are all about trying to optimize the distribution of resources. The only difference is that capitalism relies on distributed processing and communism relies on a central processor. So that's a nice idea, but it's an incredibly blunt way of thinking about political systems because it crudely overlooks their underlying politics, values, and normative premises. And indeed, algorithmic regulation itself has been associated with two dramatically different political visions. We have O'Reilly on the one hand, who advocates the turn to algorithmic regulation and imagines a seamless, fully automated, data-driven governance that solves societal coordination problems as efficiently as a Google search engine. And we have technology critic Evgeny Morozov, who seeks to expose what he sees as the anti-democratic vision of Silicon Valley's belief that technological innovation can solve social problems effectively simply by harnessing the power of the internet. Well, I don't have time to go through Morozov's critique, but he identifies certain features associated with this thinking that he refers to as solutionism. It's all about governing effects, not causes. It's about expanding oversight and collecting as much data as you can. And he points out this is not the small libertarian state. Encourage individuals to look after themselves because all their problems are really just a product of not behaving well. And finally, characterize individuals as entrepreneurs and the sharing economy as the new welfare state. Well, if we combine this solutionist mindset, some other critics are claiming that it is being hypercharged by the logic of global capitalism, and an incredibly powerful, incisive critique is provided by Harvard scholar Shoshana Zuboff, who claims that we're witnessing the emergence of a new and powerful logic of accumulation that she refers to as surveillance capitalism. Driven, she says, by Silicon Valley's hyperscale tech companies that achieve growth primarily by leveraging automation via these global digital platforms. On this logic, she says, revenues don't depend upon data assets appropriated through ubiquitous automated operations, constituting a new asset class, surveillance assets, generating a new default business model where company valuations routinely depend on eyeballs rather than revenue as a predictor of profitability, channeling and controlling flows of information, converting them to flows of profit, all in ways that are highly opaque to their users. Well, there is also a literature from surveillance studies which points out that surveillance capitalism relies critically on highly granular, population-wide, continuously updated mass surveillance, all made possible by network digital infrastructures. But interestingly, unlike the repressive forms of visual surveillance that we're familiar with in Orwell's Big Brother, we see a distinctly Western democratic type of surveillance emerging. And the core logic is that we willingly allow ourselves to be subject to algorithmic scrutiny because we exchange our personal data for the efficiency and convenience of Alexa, for example. So this model is possible because of the underlying data protection laws that we have that are essentially rest on a model of privacy self-management. That it's really up to you. You can consent to exchanging your personal data for convenience and efficiency, but legal scholars have trenchantly criticized this model as inadequate in a big data environment because of the practical impossibility of providing meaningful consent in the complicated data ecosystem that we now encounter. Is this something we should worry about? Well, yes, because it's not just at the individual level that we're trading away our personal data. We're also doing it at the collective level. So, for example, three London hospitals have exchanged 1.6 million patient records with Google in return for pro bono development of healthcare analytics. And my worry is that our consent to this exchange might not be true consent. It might be a little bit more like the consent of the compulsive gambling addict. For Shoshana Zuboff, it is a Faustian pact. And as Pam has already pointed out, and Bill Davido has written an excellent article about this, as a result of this exchange, millions of people are now virtually incarcerated in algorithmic prison, with many people unable, due to their internet profiles, to find employment. They have difficulty accessing various services, including insurance, loan finance, renting houses, purchasing properties, or even boarding an aeroplane. Legal scholars also share some of these concerns, highlighting how algorithmic decision making may antagonize some really important constitutional values, such as transparency and accountability. Because the processes are highly opaque and difficult to understand, it's very difficult for individuals to understand why they are being treated in a particular way, and they might not even know the behavior that condemned them in the first place. Obviously, there are threats to informational privacy that are threatened by algorithmic regulation, which may jeopardize individual autonomy. But I'm a bit concerned that a legal rights framework doesn't really solve the problem for us because of the way profiling works. There are real problems with due process and rights of appeal. Who do I challenge when I have been excluded from some service on the basis of a profile which I have no access to? And due process is a really core constitutional principle. The problem is that historically it only applies to governmental decisions, but increasingly it is the large commercial providers that have the power to exclude. And finally, of course, there are concerns about discrimination and equality of treatment. Well, all of this, of course, is of enormous concern because of the power asymmetries that are emerging. And even the World Economic Forum, which has been a very staunch advocate of digital transformation, recognizes that the governance issues associated with these techniques, because of the power asymmetry, need to be addressed in order to protect the rights and claims of individuals, particularly given that individuals simply lack power to pose any serious challenge in which the way in which power is currently distributed clearly favours institutions, both public and private, and individuals are basically passive data subjects who lack any meaningful influence and control over the disposition and use of their personal data. So the World Economic Forum says we need to ensure that these algorithms that are driving these kinds of decisions are lawful, fair, and can be explained intelligibly, but it's not quite clear what this requires and how we achieve it. Well, some people might say, well, that's all very well and good, but can't we just solve this by putting a human in the loop? I don't think it solves the problem. It may solve the problem on a sporadic basis. It is not a systematic solution. Why? A number of reasons. Merely keeping a human in the loop doesn't satisfy the demands of due process. I've met many individuals who don't understand due process. Secondly, even if a human retains formal authority to make a decision, that authority can itself be improperly exercised or abused. Individuals might not know they've been subject to an adverse decision based on algorithmic evaluation, but this lack of awareness doesn't legitimize the decision. Humans are highly susceptible to automation bias, that we tend to defer to computational judgments even when we recognize that the situation calls for another choice. And even recommender systems can be very powerful forms of choice architecture that can manipulate in subtle but highly effective ways, which I've referred to elsewhere as hypernudge. So recognition of the rise of algorithmic power and the inscrutability of its processes are driving demands for algorithmic accountability, highlighting the need for effective governance mechanisms through which algorithmic decisions can be explained and justified to those affected against some criteria and to make amends for any fault or error. And this need for explainability is particularly important in liberal democratic societies. So if you want to be North Korea, then it doesn't matter. Explainability doesn't matter. But if you care about being a liberal democracy, then explainability is absolutely fundamental, as Political philosopher Jeremy Waldron put it, a liberal society aspires to be a transparent order, in that its workings and principles should be well known, available for public apprehension and scrutiny, so that the social order can be justified to those who live under it. So these concerns, they're not just individual level concerns. They highlight the risks to collective values of transparency and accountability that might be jeopardized by a wholesale shift towards algorithmic decision-making systems, because these systems risk eroding the collective moral and cultural fabric upon which democracy and individual freedom rests. In other words, privacy isn't just an individual right, it is a collective good. It is a zone of protection, it's a form of moral infrastructure around which each individual's activities within a society take place. They make it possible for us to flourish as individuals, to engage in projects of self-creation in which our sense of self emerges. We can play around with who we are, and without it, there is no democratic or individual freedom. But this collective dimension, the importance of this critical moral and social infrastructure, is frequently overlooked in contemporary debates. So finally, I just want to contrast algorithmic systems with the legitimacy and logic of constitutional democratic systems of governing. And this point was made by legal philosopher Murray Hildebrand, who pointed out that the reason why we think constitutional democracies are legitimate is because they render sovereign rule legitimate via a double form of transparency. Firstly, that people live under rules of their own making. Someone else didn't make them for them. They made them for themselves. That is democratic participation. And secondly, that the application of those rules can be contested via a procedure that is capable of opening the black box of their interpretation, otherwise known as the rule of law. This generates a cybernetic system, constitutional democracy, in which all who live under the rule of law are not objects to be controlled, but subjects participating in collective self-rule, accountable to each other and to their government. In conclusion, then, my worry is that algorithmic regulation, in the form that it's currently emerging in contemporary modern democracies, threatens this constitutional balance. It seems to be providing a one-way mirror that allows institutions to look down to surveil those below, but those below have no real prospect of peering into, let alone understanding and challenging these algorithmic black boxes that regulate their lives. But it doesn't have to be like this. These are political choices. The systems that we make are based on value trade-offs about how we want to live, about what kind of society we want to create. So it is at least theoretically possible to imagine a more egalitarian, progressive system of algorithmic regulation. We could imagine algorithmic systems operating as two-way mirrors, where customers could monitor the performance of corporate service providers and government providers, who are at the same time monitoring their adherence to laws and contracts. So it might not just be my employer who monitors my performance, but I might also be simultaneously monitoring the way in which my employer is performing. However, these are not the kind of algorithmic platforms that Silicon Valley startups are keen to develop. That's hardly surprising. They do not offer the kind of lucrative financial returns that accrue to the giant digital platforms that wield asymmetrical power in relation to their users. So I'm afraid I doubt that these kind of more progressive egalitarian systems will emerge spontaneously from the capitalist market order without political intervention. So it seems to me that in order to develop the kinds of systems of governance that we need, the core challenge lies in the political realm. How can we foster active, meaningful debate and deliberation that can shape and inform and constrain the way in which algorithmic systems are developed and are implemented that will reflect the core values and aspirations of the populations which these systems increasingly regulate? Thank you. I've gone on for a bit long. I welcome your questions.